to read a vision I had in this book, Revelations from God, Prophet's Journal. This is volume one. There's two volumes. This first one, there's a teaching at the front on visions. You know, you need to understand visions. There's four types of visions, and then there's a trance. God speaks to us through visions and dreams. And then the second Revelations from God deals with, or has a teaching in the front on revelation. Just as there's different types of visions, there's different types of revelation. Now, this was a vision in April, on April the 9th of 1998. We were living in Helena, Montana. I'm just going to read this to you because it's very interesting. It deals with what we're involved with today. My wife, Evie, is half Cherokee. Her father was Cherokee and her mother Irish. One of the nations God has given us is the Indian nations, the Native Americans. When we met the Lord, He gave Ev my vision for Africa and He gave me her vision for the Native Americans. The Lord showed me back then that the people that He made with the greatest warring spirit were the Native Americans. We've ministered to them in both America and Canada. As I was thinking about them on this day, this was 1998, as I said, the Lord spoke and He said, quote, call a council of war, said the Father to the Great Spirit. It's time for war. Speak to my war chiefs, those who can hear my voice. Call them from the four corners of the earth. Speak to the waters. Let the winds carry my word. It's time for war. The days of peace have ended. Call a war council. It's time for war. Throughout the world, men speak of peace, but I am for war. That's Psalm 120, verse 7. So, God is calling for war by who? By the church. Because who has spiritual authority in the earth? It's the church. And one good thing that's come out of all this corruption over the election in America is just, I think it's finally awakened the sleeping church. Because people are now beginning to war. You know, we found over the years that so many people, especially in Africa and Asia, and especially West Africa, understand spiritual warfare because they fight witches and wizards and magicians. They fight Satan's kingdom. But here in America, churches aren't interested in spiritual warfare. And as a result, how are you going to win a battle if you're not engaged in warfare? You know, the first thing Jesus did when He began His ministry was to confront the dark kingdom. There can be no realization that the kingdom of God has come near to the earth if you don't drive out and exercise authority over the person who has authority, which is the devil. You know, one of the biggest misconceptions Christians have, I've found over the years, is they believe that because God's sovereign, He can do whatever He wants. And that's not true, because God limited Himself through covenant. So He's given, the Lord Jesus gave His authority to His body, the church, and He expects us to use it. And He's expecting us to use it to contest this election that's going on, because the devil, as we all know, has tried to steal it, to destroy the nation and destroy the church. That's his objective. It's control to destroy the church. They've already muzzled so many states they can't even meet. It's illegal, or you'd be arrested. That's against the Constitution, my brothers and sisters. But yet the government only seems to care about that when it's in their interest to do so. Separation of church and state. I want to talk a little bit about the natives, because there's a parallel between what went on with them and what's going on now. You know, Chief Sitting Bull was a great warrior. He was also a medicine man, but he banded the Lakota tribes together. He was involved in leading the warriors, mostly Crazy Horse, Gall, and others, to victory at the Battle of Little Bighorn. Sitting Bull and his people were given a treaty by the United States government in 1868, and all the treaties that were ever given, I've read about this years ago, and we broke all of them. And what this demonstrates is something that I wrote in Mysterious Secrets years ago, 30 years ago, and that is that the dominant spirit over Washington, D.C. is a lying spirit. You see, spirits like to congregate together, and the dominant spirit in Washington is a lying spirit. People will lie when there's no reason to do so. That's the nature of a lying spirit. So we broke all these treaties. Now, in 1868, the Lakotas were given the Black Hills. They considered it sacred. But in 1874, gold was discovered. And so guess what the American government did? They just said, well, we're not going to honor that treaty. And they began to try to move them off their land. And that's what caused the wars. But the tragedy of Sitting Bull, he finally, after Little Bighorn, went up to Canada, and to escape persecution by the United States Army. And when the general came up there and tried to talk him into coming back, he said, go back to Washington and take your lies with you. But unfortunately, some years later, they did convince him to come back, and then they murdered him. And you see, that is that spirit of control, the spirit of control. And we deal with it a lot in families. And I know anyone watching this, if you think about it, you'll know a lot about the spirit of control. You know people that have used it, or maybe it's been used on you. The spirit of control wants to manipulate and control you, and that's satanic. Even God doesn't control us. And the last gasp for a spirit of control, if people wake up to it, is violence. It's to beat you or to kill you or to threaten you. So that spirit of control is really how Washington operates. They try to control. It's been corrupt. My wife and I have prayed for over 30 years for everything to be exposed, all the corruption. And frankly, I knew a lot of things. I have for many, many years. But it's actually worse than I thought. I mean, there's more people involved than I thought. Huge part of the government is involved in this. We call it the deep state government. And it's led by what I call the devil's party, because they're the devil's party. They used to be the Democrat party, but now they're the devil's party because they act just like the devil. Lie, cheat, steal, murder. They make millions of dollars a year from abortion, and God wants to stop that. You know, the blood pollutes the land, and the blood cries out, especially the blood of innocents. And if you read Mysterious Secrets, you know that Satan loves the sacrifice, especially of innocent blood. Because Satan and all the higher demons, they drink human blood. So they love the devil's party because they bring him blood. Now, as I said, my wife and I have taught for 30 years on fivefold ministry. Now, see, the church, Jesus Christ set the church up to function through fivefold ministry, sometimes called ascension gift ministries. It's Ephesians chapter 4, if you want to study it. And he left apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist. Now some, especially evangelicals who don't know much about the anointing, they believe that teacher, pastor are the same, but they're not. One of the spiritual gifts that I was given when I was young and I didn't understand it, I had to figure it out, as I shared with our brother that was here this Thanksgiving with us, that God gives you spiritual gifts, but he doesn't give you a manual. He expects you to seek him and spend time and learn what your gifts are and how they function. But I can see the anointing, so I can tell you there's five separate anointings. And what people put on their card, whether it's apostle or prophet or evangelist or pastor, that's not what makes them what it is. It's the anointing by the Spirit. When God calls you, he anoints you. And he anoints you for a specific office if he's called you to fivefold ministry. Now, in the New Testament, these fivefold ministers, sometimes we see prophet, we see apostle, we see evangelist, we see the word pastor, but generally we just see the word elder. There are several Greek words, presbyter, elder, bishop, episkopos is the word that's translated bishop, which is an English word. But they're really all the same. The elders are fivefold ministers. Doesn't mean you're a pastor just because you say you're a pastor. You may be anointed as a prophet, like certain people are, but because the church has never been taught about fivefold ministry, I mean, as I said, we've been teaching on it, emphasizing it for 30 years. Can't see that it's done a lot of good, so many people. Or some churches will even say, oh, yeah, we believe in fivefold ministry, but they don't. They don't practice it. They don't understand it. And one of the things that you have to develop spiritually is you have to develop your spirit man. And you do that through prayer and the Word, mostly. The Holy Spirit gave me a term back in 1999 called the Eye of the Eagle. And we get emails every week from people asking, how do I get the Eye of the Eagle? Well, the Eye of the Eagle is the ability to see into the spirit realm, because the eagle is a symbol of both the Lord Jesus Christ and the prophet's office. So that you have the Eye of the Eagle, you're able to see into the spirit realm. And some of the subsequent teachings that we'll do on here, I'll be teaching about that for people that are interested. So, let's get down to talking about the election. I have some other vision here I want to read. Because I think it's important as far as the election goes. That's just kind of the way God does things. I want to read a scripture to you, and I got in revelation on this many years ago. But when you read things, you know, one of the things about God is he has application for then and also generally for the future. Like many things that happened in the past reoccur in the future, or they reoccur in a different way. For example, we're talking about America here. When the Continental Congresses were meeting, John Adams and George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, all those folks, when they were meeting, they had a difficulty getting a resolution for independence. Because of what? Because of the Quakers. Now, the Quakers settled the colony, the Pennsylvania. It's very interesting if you study the history, and we have some Christian friends who wrote a book on it. And I've been to the Capitol, the Capitol, the state of Pennsylvania, it's just scriptures. I mean, the rotunda, there's stained glass scripture of John chapter 8. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Years ago, when they were all trying to get everything of God removed from Capitol, they said, well, we can't do anything in Pennsylvania because we'd have to raise the whole building because it's all our scripture and statues and the Word of God's everywhere because of the Quakers. Now, William Penn founded that colony. Now, his father was very wealthy, and his father had loaned a lot of money to the English crown so that they could fight wars. And William Penn asked the crown to cede him that colony of Pennsylvania in repayment for that debt. But the Quakers were pacifists. They didn't believe in war. And so that's what kept the independence or the fight for independence, the War of Independence, from being accomplished sooner. Now, today we have a similar situation. It's spiritual. We have had a pacifist church that hasn't wanted to fight. And you can't win a battle if you're not willing to fight. As I shared in Mysterious Secrets, Satan has no mercy. And in the spirit realm, if you're born again, you're always clothed in white. So they know if you're a true Christian or not. Now, there are people who go to church. Satan calls them, he calls them churchgoers. Now, they're not dressed in white. Why? Because they've not really been born again. There's a lot of that. You know, Satan's very smart. You can go to church, doesn't make you a Christian. You have to repent of your sins, profess faith in Jesus Christ, be water baptized by immersion, and then you're baptized into the body of Christ. So, the church has been pacifist. We haven't been wanting to fight, and now it's being forced upon us. One of God's objectives, as I'm going to share. Now, many people, in fact, I was speaking with a Nigerian pastor friend of mine who's in California several months ago, before the election, back in October, actually, or maybe it was September. He was talking about how so many of his people in his congregation, you know, they hate Trump and they don't, he made the statement, they don't understand governmental anointing, and that's true. You see, God anoints who he wants. Now, if you followed our ministry for any length of time, you know, and we had a Facebook page for the ministry back years ago, back in, I can't remember when we started it, but like 2010 or something like that. And then in 2015, I posted things on there about the day that Donald Trump announced he was running for president. And I went and prayed, and the Lord showed me that he was raising him up as a Cyrus. Now, a lot of people have gotten that, I found out. But the Lord also told me he was raising him up as a Josiah. Now, there's a couple of interesting things about that. Number one, those are the only two kings in the scriptures that their name was prophesied 100 years before they were born. And they were both kings. Cyrus was a Gentile heathen king, whereas Josiah was a king of Judah. And he was the last godly king. So if you don't understand what that means, that Donald Trump was raised up as a Cyrus and a Josiah, then you should meditate on it and you should study the lives of those two kings. Let the Lord speak to you. So, what is God doing with this election? What is he doing? Well, number one, he's exposing corruption to establish justice. He's exposing corruption to establish justice. And it's one of the reasons that I believe it may go to the Supreme Court. I want to read a vision that I had. It's in this first Revelations from God, which was published in 2007, I believe, 7 or 8. Vision of the Supreme Court, Libby, Montana. This was on December 30th of 2005. We were living in Libby, Montana then. We established a church. We were on the radio. was during the president's nomination and Senate confirmation hearings for two Supreme Court nominees, Roberts and Samuel Alito. I was laying in the floor of my living room in Montana praying when a vision broke, and I saw the Supreme Court of the United States. There was a huge river of blood flowing down the steps of the court. And whenever you have a vision like that from the Lord, you never forget it. And what I can tell you, it's like I'm looking at the doors. I'm looking at the front. I'm down at the bottom of the steps, and I'm looking at the doors, and it's like they burst open. And it was really more like a huge waterfall turning into a river. I mean, it burst the doors open. There's so much pressure, spiritual pressure. That's what's going on in this vision. So there was a huge river of blood flowing down the steps of the court. Numbers 35:33 says, quote, "Bloodshed pollutes the land," close quote. And the highest court of our land has contributed to much bloodshed, especially through the Roe v. Wade ruling in 1973. God is judging this nation as a result. In fact, back in the 80s, the Lord spoke to me and said, when these random shootings began, when someone in Dallas walked up, or Irving, Texas, walked up to someone in a mall and just shot them in the head, they didn't even know them. And the Lord said to me that because of Roe v. Wade and the bloodshed, that it had loosed the spirit of murder in America. And that's why we've seen more and more and more murders. But people don't ever understand, even in the church, that things that you see, there's a root cause in the spirit realm. Generally, like if you're sick, if there's a disease upon your body, you're promised health and wholeness and wellness through covenant. God's obligated by covenant to heal you. I'll probably talk about that in one of the broadcasts because you need to understand. We've seen people healed of terminal diseases by sharing that revelation that God's obligated by covenant to heal you. He is. He's obligated by covenant to provide for you. You shouldn't ever be concerned about provision. If you trust your earthly father to provide for you, how much more should you not entrust your heavenly Father? Amen? So, God's obligated by covenant. And bloodshed pollutes the land. The vision did not speak specifically about abortion, although this is the greatest sin in America today. There's no doubt a reason for blood to flow down the steps of the Supreme Court. Rather, the vision, now this is what, when you have a vision, you sense things in your spirit. Sometimes you see things, but you're also sensing something in your spirit. And it may be contrary to what you're seeing, or it may explain what you're seeing. It may be, you might think it might be at odds with what you're seeing. I always tell people, check your spirit. Check your spirit. Don't listen to your head. Check your spirit. Your spirit is alive to God because the Holy Spirit's living here. So I said that the vision, this is what was in my spirit, speaks in general about the lack of true justice in our land today. Remember, God judged Israel for this. The book of Amos is full of this indictment. It's one thing for injustice to occur, however, and quite another for the third branch of government, the branch that is supposed to endorse and uphold justice. If you've ever been to the Supreme Court, they have a statue of Lady Justice, and she's blind. You see, justice is blind. True justice is blind. It's not dependent on race or color or wealth. But that's not what we have in America. We don't have true justice. So it's one thing for the third branch of government, the branch that's supposed to endorse and uphold justice, to make decisions having nothing to do with true justice. And we've seen that as the court had become liberal. They're making policy. I mean, we're seeing it now in this election with the way the courts are ruling, saying they're basically no evidence when they have hundreds or maybe even thousands of affidavits that there's been fraud committed. Oh, well, the judge says there's no evidence. He's corrupt. He's not wanting to give justice because he's a member of the devil's party. So, this causes the innocent and the poor to suffer the most, and ultimately will bring God's judgment or justice to pass upon America. Now, that was 2005. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He shows us things to come, doesn't he? So I want to read this scripture because this is what's going on. It has to do with Jesus' birth after he was born. His days of purification, according to the law of Moses, were completed. And this is Luke chapter 2, if you want to study it yourself. They brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Now, this was all specified, of course, in the Old Testament, right? You had to make an offering to the Lord. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. What does that mean? Holy Spirit was upon him. He probably felt the anointing. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit. Now, how was it revealed? Well, that's called revelation gifts. We have a book called The Gifts and Operations of the Holy Spirit. If you're not familiar with the nine gifts of the Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians 12, then you should read that book. But it was revealed to him that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit. How about that? He was moved by the Spirit. Spirit. He was sensitive to the Spirit. He had the eye of the eagle, which is something that you need. Into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, and he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which are spoken of him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother. Now this is a prophetic word, a personal prophecy. When you're reading the word, you need to understand spiritual gifts. You need to ask yourself questions like, what spiritual gifts in manifestation? What's going on here? Simeon begins to prophesy, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel. The fall and rising of many in Israel. And for a sign which will be spoken against. Jesus was a sign that was spoken against. Generally, when God sends a sign, people will speak against it. Lord gave me a message for our church in Libby back in 2004. That's also a message for the entire church called The Prophet and the Sign. Very often when God calls a prophet, he gives them a sign. Moses had two signs, if you'll recall. But very often a prophet will have a particular sign. When Elijah came on the scene, he said, there'll be no rain or dew except at my word. Verse 35, yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also. And Mary's soul was certainly pierced when she had to observe the beating and the hanging of her son on the cross. Her firstborn on the cross. Now, this is the key verse I want to get to. It's the last part of 35. That the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Jesus, one of his purposes, you see it right there in that personal prophecy, is to reveal hearts. And that's what's going on throughout the world today. You know, when Israel departed from the Lord and made a golden calf, when Moses came down, he was angry and he threw the tablets of stone and broke them. Then he said, who's on the Lord's side? Who is on the Lord's side? Are you serving the Lord or are you serving Baal? So God is exposing corruption to establish justice. Number two, he's awakening a sleeping church to warfare. I have to tell you, I'm pretty proud when I look at what's going on. People are woken up. They've awakened. They're fighting. They're praying. They're decreeing. They're learning spiritual authority. Now, I wish they'd done it years ago. Like I said, I warned in October. You can read the blog, October of 2018, that if we didn't pray for Trump because of the attacks against him, anyone who's even watched this man knows, and it's been lonely for him. I can tell you, I've seen the man in the spirit. He's just been, and people don't understand. They think that the Democrats and others are angry at him, other people, the media, because of his what he tweets on Twitter or this. So that's not it. It's the anointing. The devil hates the anointing. If you're anointed by God, the devil's going to come after you. And he's the first president in this situation that I've ever seen that was anointed by God. So they're going to come after him. And it's been nonstop. It's been basically a rolling coup attempt to take him from power because they're afraid of the corruption he has been exposing. Number three, now this is interesting. God wants to force the bride to prepare herself. Now I mentioned passivism earlier with the Quakers and the fact that the church now is waking up to the fact that we can't be passive anymore. In 2014, the Lord spoke to me in Williston, North Dakota, and he said, the greatest persecution against the church in the future is going to come in America. And I've seen that after Trump leaves office. Now, it may not be right after, but during the time when he leaves office, things are going to get real dark here. Because the church has spiritual authority. So the devil wants to destroy it. And then, of course, his crowd wants us to just rubber stamp transgender marriage, and allowing 8-year-old children to be transgendered and all this garbage, saying there's 72 sexes and just nonsense, just complete nonsense. So God is forcing the bride to prepare herself. Now, I believe, based on some supernatural, angel appeared to me back in the 1982 to speak about the return of the Lord. And I believe, based on some things he told me and I've written about it, I believe the Lord wanted to return in 2012. Why didn't he? See, people don't realize that the church has a part to play. The Lord said to me in 1998, he said, when the bride is ready, the bridegroom will appear. And that is verified in the scriptures, isn't it? It says in Revelation that the bride made herself ready. Well, the church, the bride of Christ, hasn't made herself ready. We've been sleeping. Remember the parable of the virgins. Five were wise and five were foolish. Speaks about the church because they are all waiting for the bridegroom. And yet five were not prepared and did not make themselves ready. So it's forcing the bride to prepare herself. Number four, It's going to, it has been exposing Satan's spirit of control. His spirit of control. I talked about that a little bit earlier. But I want to read a vision to you that I had twice, actually. Because there's a lot of control in the church, or what we call the church. I don't call it the church. You see, I've learned over the years, because our area of expertise, you know, it's not prayer. It's, well, my wife knows a lot more about prayer than I do, but it's fivefold ministry, the anointing, and it's the devil's kingdom, how it's organized. It's all laid out in mysterious secrets. So I know a lot about the devil. And then God, when he moved us from Austin, Texas to Helena, Montana, and began to pour out revelation about the false church, it just blew me away. I was having, never had a time of revelation like that. Like sometimes I'd have 10 visions a day. And most of it had to do with the false church. Some of it had to do with power of words and other things, but the false church, the false church. You see, Satan's strategy, since we see his strategy in the scriptures, it was to stop the prophecy of Genesis 3:15 of the Messiah. But once he failed at that, his strategy has been to destroy the true churches and to raise up false churches. And he does that by killing off the true churches. Most of the churches that were very anointed, that we ministered in America, miracles, they're no longer existing. The devil's destroyed them because they didn't take spiritual warfare seriously. And you need to take it seriously, because the Holy Spirit told me in 1980, he said, "Son, the power of the devil will become so strong in the last days that only those who are strong in the word and faith will survive," which is another reason you need to build your faith and live by faith. So you need to read Living in the Now of Faith. Praise God. So he wants to expose the spirit of control. So many churches, I've learned, the devil controls most churches. Now, they may not be a satanic church in the sense that that's another subject that would take a long time to discuss. But Satan controls churches generally through people. I mean, it could have started as a genuine church, but through even the pastor or the pastor's wife. As I shared in this book, Another Gospel, written last year, there are so many false gospels out there, false churches preaching a false gospel with a false spirit and a false Jesus. You need to know the difference. Amen? So, control. This is a vision of the fat baby, I called it. Fat baby. It was in Portland, Oregon on two occasions. First was February the 5th, 2001. And the second time, I think it was the next time we went over there, which God used to send us to Portland a lot to minister. On March the 16th of 2001, I had the same vision, but it was different in that there was more information added, and God does that very often. I received this vision twice in a short period of time, and it had to do with the largest Pentecostal church in Portland, where we were doing some ministry and teaching on deliverance. This particular church was named Deliverance Tabernacle when it was founded back in the 40s. And at this time now, they didn't even believe in deliverance. In fact, this executive pastor gave me this treatise from their 72 elders who said basically that they didn't believe a Christian can have a demon and they didn't, you know, blah, blah, blah. He handed it to me, and I said, "I'm not going to read that. Why would I read it? It's nonsense." I was taken into a vision where I saw this incredibly fat baby sitting and trying to move while somebody was attempting to feed it food with a spoon, which it vehemently refused. It was so obese that it was having difficulty moving its arms and legs around. The scriptural reference for this vision is Paul's writings to the Corinthian church, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2, if you want to look it up. During the second time I received this vision on March 16th, I knew that it also represented the fact that there was a spirit of control in the church that wanted to keep all of the babies infants in spiritual development. And this was the reason they were only being fed milk and they only desired their normal diet of milk. See, the baby wouldn't eat food. It just wanted milk. This church, like any church, will not grow properly as God plans until these control spirits are dealt with. I also thought about how in the natural a consultant can come into a business and just observe the organizational climate to tell a lot about what needs to change. Normally, these needed changes are unobserved by both the CEO and the employees, but someone that's experienced can see it. And in the fivefold offices, that's the apostle. Sometimes the prophet, because he gets revelation, but the apostles have the organizational structure and ability to see things like this. The same is true for a church. A spiritual person gifted as a prophet or apostle can come into a church and know by the Spirit what is going on spiritually and what is holding back that church from following the Holy Spirit. See, my brother and sister, God gives all of us spiritual gifts. Now, as I said earlier, he doesn't give you a manual. He doesn't tell you what gifts you have. It's your responsibility to determine those, or fivefold ministry. We can help you with that. It's been my observation under the nine gifts of the Spirit, everyone generally will have two or three that are dominant in their life. All of them might function through you. Now you need to understand what they are and how they function, because they function different ways. But normally two or three function through each individual. But in most churches, they won't allow you to operate in your gifts. And Paul said in 1 Corinthians that that weakens the church. And this is what God has showed us about the spirit of control. He wants you to be free. He wants you to have an atmosphere where you can flow in your gifts and minister. We're supposed to minister those gifts to one another, first to the body of Christ, and then to the world as the Spirit leads us. Every church should have a healing team. They should have a deliverance team. They should have prophets. What does the word say? Let the prophets speak, two or three. That means there should be prophets in the church. I talked about this 30 years ago on Mysterious Secrets. So, God wants to expose Satan's spirit of control, not just in America. How do they work in Washington? You know how they work? And you know why the FBI, they've been corrupt for years. It was exposed in the Wall Street Journal, the front page back in the 80s. They call them like the last bastion of, you know, honest government. They've probably been corrupt longer than that. But they were caught falsifying forensic lab data to convict people. Why? So some prosecutor could get promoted. He didn't care if people went to prison, if he could get promoted. Well, now what we see is they've been turned into a spy organization. Why do they spy on people? Why does the NSA spy on people? To get information about you. Why? To control you. And there are people in very high levels, like in the Supreme Court, who are being controlled. And they generally have two ways to control you. They either bribe you with money or they threaten you. And how can they threaten you if they don't have information? By following you, listening into your phone calls and all that. That's why they spied on Trump. Amen? So, the Supreme Court is a test for justice to see if this election goes to the Supreme Court, if there's going to be true justice. And that's why I believe it will go to the Supreme Court. and we'll see if there's true justice. And I believe there will be, and I believe that Donald Trump will serve a second term. Now, the Lord hasn't told me anything specifically. I don't have a thus saith the Lord. On November 9th, which is almost a week after the election, the Holy Spirit said to me, when you're in the fire, look for the fourth man to appear. When you're in the fire, look for the fourth man to appear. What a powerful word that is, because it's not, our nation is in the fire now, and the church is in the fire, but you also have times in your own life when you're in the fire. And when you're in the fire, look around. The fourth man will appear. Bless you. Have a wonderful day. We love you. We're here to help you. Email us. Come on our website. We'll help you in your Christian walk and in your giftings. Praise the Lord.